Thank you so much, Reba. Appreciate that. Good morning. Wow, I'm loud today. Good morning and welcome to this time of worship here at the First Baptist Church. It is such a beautiful morning. I thought it was springtime already, then checked the calendar. January the whatever this is, the 17th. And glad that we can be here on this day to open our hearts, open our minds, and worship God together. Thankful for this time, and we will share some announcements in just a few minutes. Let me see, they are rolling. Yes. You can see the, those of you who see the screens can see that the flowers on either side of me here are given to the glory of God and in celebration of the birthday of her dear father by Vicki Smith. Dick is having a birthday this week. I thought you stopped counting.
I did. I sent an email to my daughter.
You've already told her not to do that, but she did it anyway. Okay. It's on the 19th. That's 2 days from now, in case you want to harass him. Let me see. Comfort Shaw Ministry meeting is happening tomorrow at 1 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. There are a number of people that are still crocheting and working on Shaws to be distributed to oncology patients and others who have special needs when they are ill at home or in therapy. Board of Christian Education is meeting here on Tuesday night at 6 o'clock, and they'll be meeting downstairs in the Fellowship Hall as well. Annual business meeting. Some of you may have heard this announcement in previous weeks, but we want to keep announcing that for you. The annual business meeting is not this next week, but the 31st, the last day of the month, the last Sunday of the month. And we are having it on a Sunday when we know most of you are here instead of trying to have it on a Wednesday night. Boards and committees are going to meet to reorganize right after that meeting, as new officers will be elected at that time. You see some leftovers here, some poinsettias that have not been claimed. Those persons who purchased them claimed the ones that they wanted. If you'd like to take one home, if you'd like to plant one and see if you can make it bloom again, please just leave the plastic plates here underneath, but take those along with you if you would like. And let me see, anything else happening? I have one other thing. Most of you should have received a letter this week, looked something like this, except maybe yours was folded up in the envelope. Just letting you know that different documents will be available for you next week in anticipation of the business meeting. But today, out at the table as you leave, there are copies of our Constitution and bylaws with corrections and suggested changes in those. According to the Constitution, those need to be available to church members 2 weeks in advance of the meeting. So if you'd want to pick one of those up on your way out today, you can have that. But treasurer's report, annual reports from boards and committees, as well as other information, will be available next Sunday in anticipation of the board meeting. As we begin our time today, I want to share just a few verses with you from Psalm 139. This is a time that, what did I say a few weeks ago on Christmas Eve? I used the phrase from the novel and said, these are the times that try men's souls. Psalm 139, though, tells us this. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, that I know very well. Let's worship God together this morning. As we finish our Christmas season last week, I realized that there is one song that helps cover the gap with that. Thou didst leave thy throne. And we are singing three of those verses of the five today. But sing with me this wonderful hymn of the church. Let's sing together. Thou didst leave thy throne and thy kingly crown when thou comest to earth for me. But in Bethlehem's home was there found no room for the holy nativity. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus, there is room in my heart for thee. The foxes found rest and the birds their nest in the shade of the forest tree. But thy couch was the sod, O thou Son of God, in the deserts of Galilee. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus, there is room in my heart for thee. When the heavens shall ring and I'll sing at thy coming to victory, let thy voice call me home, saying, yet there is room, there is room at my side for thee. My heart shall rejoice, Lord Jesus, when thou comest and callest for thee. Let's pray together. Gracious God, thank you. Thank you for the privilege we have of being here together this morning, for that opportunity to see one another, but also, oh God, just to be in your presence and to worship you. We thank you. We thank you for loving us and giving us your Son, Jesus, that we have celebrated over these past couple of months, his birth, his dedication. And Lord, we look ahead to how he influenced and how he taught. And we thank you for his presence in our lives. And oh God, we ask today that you help us to know and hear the prayer even more fervently today as we pray the prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I am finding that in the midst of the weather as it shifts my throat, it gets drier all the time. I don't know whether you have that problem, but I am shifting a cough drop from side to side. I hope it stays there instead of projecting somewhere. I know that among all of us, there are dates that come to mind that stick in our minds. And for me, one of those was yesterday. Yesterday, January 16th, 1944, was the day my parents were married. And I started calculating and I thought, wow, that would have been 77 years. Those days stick with us. The birth, the death, the marriage dates, significant dates in our lives when family members are born. And we remember those and we give God thanks for those special times, even as we mark them on the calendar or in our hearts as we share them together. I need you to know that in the past few days, I have read warnings regarding churches and houses of worship that have alarmed me. Leaders of a couple of denominations, United Church of Christ, Presbyterian Church USA, and some others, have received credible threats that mainline church bodies are also among the targets for possible violence in the coming days. Now, we don't know all the reasons behind this or why anyone would want to do that. But we need to pray that those who are choosing the path of violence may instead be guided by the loving presence of Christ onto the road of nonviolence and peace. We see too much of it. We certainly don't want to experience it in these days ahead. Like you, I'm appalled of the need for barricades around state capitol buildings, our nation's capitol building, other buildings in D.C. I'm sorry that there is a need for 20,000-plus National Guard troops to be on the streets of Washington, but we are thankful for their presence. Never could we have imagined that domestic terrorists would be our biggest threat to a peaceful transfer of power. Today we pray for peace and calm to remain in the coming days as we look forward to the inauguration of our 46th president. Yes, we pray for the outgoing administration as they pack and do all of those things to finalize their work. And we pray for the incoming administration in these days. There are also many prayer concerns within the body of our church family and your own family and friends. As we pray together, I would ask that you pray silently today and lift those concerns to God. One of those that I have discovered is that Michelle Scepter's mother, Brenda, passed away on Wednesday, and her service will be on Tuesday at Pippin's. That's not an easy thing when Michelle is living now in California and dealing with those issues back and forth. But we remember that family and the loved ones that surround her. Let's bow in prayer this morning. Oh God, you have been our help in ages past, and you are our hope for the days to come. We give you thanks this morning for walking with us and for being present with us even today as we have come to worship you. God, we have come with open hearts and minds to hear your call to us. For many of us, oh God, we have been searching and we want to find what you have for us. Loving God, in the coming week, we will welcome a new president and vice president to lead our country. And as they begin their term, we ask your blessing on them and those who surround them, including family and cabinet members and other leaders. May they seek you as they make decisions each day. We also pray, oh God, for the outgoing administration, for all of those people who have surrounded the president and the vice president. Be with them as they shift from those responsibilities to others in the days ahead. This day, oh God, we want to lift up those whose families have been affected by this coronavirus. There are those within our congregation who have been diagnosed with COVID-19. There are others who are part of extended families and friends that we know have tested positive and they're enduring the symptoms. And God, we ask for your presence with them and your healing hand. Give them the strength for each new day as they deal with the fevers, the aches, the breathing issues. God, we thank you that there has been research that has been going on for years but has culminated in vaccines that are going to make a difference. And we ask, oh God, that this life-saving remedy will be available. Help us each as we watch and we wait for our turn. But we pray also, God, for those who are working long hours in hospitals and clinics and nursing centers. We know that that opportunity for them to be infected is there at every turn. Protect them and give them the extra courage and the energy for each shift. We thank you for them and for their work. Oh God, we do pray today for those in our military, and particularly as we see them on TV, the National Guard that is surrounding our capital city. Just be with them, keep them safe. We know, oh God, that they have come from so many places across the country. Be also with our other military who are stationed across the country and around the world. Protect them, Lord, and give them your feeling of peace in these days. God, we ask today for your forgiveness. In these past days, as we have heard the news and we have watched, there have been times that we have blamed and we have accused one side or the other, and oh God, we need your forgiveness. Help us to love each one as your children. Today, help us to see each one as a brother and as a sister. And oh God, forgive us when we have sinned against you and not done the things that you would have us to do. This morning, oh God, we give you such praise and thanks for the gift of your Son, Jesus, the greatest gift that we could ever receive. And we thank you, God, that we have come to know him and that we can encourage other people to come and see and to get to know him as well. Oh Lord, we thank you and we praise you for this time together today. Open our hearts and minds that we may welcome you. We pray these things today in the name of your Son, Jesus, and for his sake. Amen. We have a song that we just want to share a couple of verses, and I'd invite you to stand with me as we share this. It's a chorus that we're going to sing a couple of times. Open our eyes, Lord. Let's stand together as we sing. Thank you for singing that prayer together today. Just water from heaven that lands on the front row. Isn't that nice? As we look to tomorrow, some of you who are still working have a holiday tomorrow because of the Martin Luther King celebration. But as we look to that tomorrow, I wanted to just share one of my favorite quotes from Dr. King. You see it on the screen, but it simply says, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that." Sometimes I need to have that where I can see it all the time, because there are times when it's the darkest, and I need to know that the light of Christ is still shining everywhere, but also that those that we say, or those situations that we say that we hate, we turn those around by loving one another. Keep that one tucked in the back of your mind, even as you step into a holiday tomorrow. You'll see a lot of different things happening on TV. There may even be events tonight as we mark those days. Today we're going to think on a theme of finding and following. A few days ago, all the trappings of Christmas that were here in the sanctuary were packed up, and they are stored away until next November. And we are moving on today. I kind of hate to do that. I still have on my telephone, I have one of the music apps, and I still have easy listening Christmas music that I'm playing as much as I can, because I don't think I've heard them all yet. But today, we're going to move on and see that Jesus grew in wisdom. The verse says he grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and humankind. But then he was baptized by John and began to find ministry partners to work with him. Never thought of it in that way, did you? We talk about Jesus called the disciples, but literally these were partners in ministry that Jesus surrounded himself with to be able to move ahead and to share the good news. Jesus didn't have job applications that he handed out, and from what we know from Scripture, he didn't have job interviews. He knew who he wanted to be with. I don't think anywhere in Scripture it says that he had a printed list and it said, "Go to the corner and look for this person." He knew who to look for as he was ready to begin his ministry. And we hear that in a passage in the first chapter of John after his baptism. I want you to listen and follow along as we find this narrative in John, the first chapter, and I'm reading verses 43 through 50 this morning. This was after his baptism, and it begins, "The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, 'Follow me.' Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. And Philip then found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered him, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." May God bless to our hearing this narrative from John this morning in this first chapter. I think it's interesting that there are a lot of finding things in John's account of the calling of Jesus' disciples. If you hear this, it says Jesus finds Philip, and then Philip finds Nathanael, and then Philip then tells Nathanael that they have found Jesus. And then Nathanael finds, well, the word isn't used there, that Jesus knows a lot more about him than he imagined. There's a lot of discovery, a lot of finding. As I read this passage, you can see on the... Wow. It's interesting, when I had that up there, I had white letters and they showed up a lot better. I'm so sorry. When I read the passage, I circled the word "found" in the text I printed off. And it was interesting because I knew that it had to be an important word in the passage because it was repeated so often. I presumed that it must mean that something could have been lost or was being searched for if it had been found. Can you imagine that? He found Nathanael. They found Jesus. It's one of the best feelings in the world, don't you know? When you are found. Any of you ever been lost? My wife raised her hand. She told our children over and over, "Oh, we're not lost. This is an adventure." As they were on some back road in Ohio or somewhere else. You know, we've read stories about persons and we've seen them on the news of somebody who's lost in the woods or they're lost somewhere and they're missing for days, and there's so much rejoicing when they are found and what that means. Maybe you've been out for a hike and you get lost. Of course, some of you haven't had that chance to be out and about. For some reason, people want us to stay in right now. But maybe you get lost and you had no idea where you are, not even a direction where you're going, and wondered how in the world you'd make it back. And then you see a trail marker or you see something that might guide you. Of course, I've discovered that in Delaware, since everything's pretty flat and the sun is, you know, one direction or here, and all the roads run pretty much north-south, it's hard to get too lost in Delaware. You'll keep driving, you'll get there. But I'll tell you, maybe it's not a geographical or a physical lostness that we deal with. Maybe there's an emotional issue of being overwhelmed. Then there are those that we know who have been lost to an addiction, and they can find help. There's a friend that may be lost with depression, and they find a sense of peace in a new relationship, or they have been helped in some ways to step out of that. Maybe there's a parent or a spouse who is lost in dementia, but still lights up when you hit on a particular memory that's tucked deep inside, and you thank God for that time. Yes, there are things that feel better. There's nothing really that feels better than being found when you are lost. Our granddaughter Amelia loves to hide, but she hides behind the sheer curtains that hang over the sliding door, and she knows that she's hidden. And you say, "Where's Amelia?" And she pulls it back and laughs and giggles because we found her. But I don't know if you've ever panicked when someone was lost and then you know the joy when they're found, literally. When Jacob was around 5 and our daughter Sarah was about 3, Rebecca and I were with them in a department store at a mall in St. Louis. We were looking at some items, and then all of a sudden, both of them were out of sight. Now, 5 and 3, we've tried to talk about stranger danger and all those other things, but it doesn't take there as much. We started looking, and we began to be a little panicky that someone could have taken them. We don't know where they are because they're just not around anywhere where we have been. After looking for a few minutes, we hear something, whether it's a conversation or a quiet whisper or a giggle, and looked deep inside around her. You know, those round racks with all the clothes hanging on them. Jacob had convinced her to hide with him. They had gone among the clothes, and they were standing up on the rack on the inside so we couldn't see their feet. And they were so pleased that they had done that, and they were so excited when they had been found. But we were pleased we found them, but just a little upset that they thought this was fun to hide from us. None of your children would have ever done anything like that. Some of you are ready to tell your own story, I think. They didn't feel lost, but to us, the joy and relief that they were found was such a great feeling. Not knowing that they were lost, and we have the story of Philip and Nathanael. Jesus goes to Galilee, and he finds Philip and simply says to him, "Follow me." As many of you know, that's a command that is repeated over and over in the Gospels. Jesus encourages others to partner with him. Come with me. We presume that Philip makes the decision to follow, and then he finds his friend Nathanael sitting over there under a fig tree and exclaims, "We have found the one who the prophets wrote about, Jesus from Nazareth." That one response that rings loudly for us as we think of others in our own lives. We have responded with this at times, and you say, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" We might say, "Can anything good come out of..." You fill in the blank. Could be a neighborhood, it could be a city, it could be a country, it could be whatever. And I've used this phrase before because you know how those people are. And it's scary when some of you nod your head because you know some of those people. Can anything good? But funny thing is, Nathanael was surprised when Jesus knew about him, just as he knows about each of us. Our abilities, our potential, our importance in the family of God are known to Jesus. It's not that we are isolated. We are not lost in that way. Jesus knows us and knows where to find us. I will tell you that right now there is a lot of lostness in our community, our country, and across the world. You know, we see the reasons for the lostness. Some of us still don't know what to do with this pandemic situation. Some people I heard yesterday were able to go down to the DMV and get their vaccine because they had more than the appointments and they couldn't toss it. So people just got an emergency call and people went to the, and they got their vaccination. Others are waiting and waiting. But there's the pandemic. There's the injustices that have been made bare over the past few months. The divisions, whether it's political or whatever it may be, there's a readiness for some reason to resort to violence to help resolve some disputes. I don't understand. A lot of lostness. And it's difficult to find answers and solutions. What we need to know and to remember is that God seems to have a heart for the lost. We affirm that when we sing that old familiar hymn. You know it, Amazing Grace. That hymn writer said, I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. He had that connection with Jesus. But we need to find our way. Oh, the joy it is when Jesus finds us. I know that many of you have a story. You have a story that is unlike any other story we could read in Scripture or in any book that has been written. About that experience when you knew that Jesus found you amidst all that was going wrong or all that you had done in the past. Or maybe it was as a child and you thought, I don't want to live without Jesus. I want you to remember this from Scripture today. Jesus found Philip and said to him, follow me. We need to remember that God keeps seeking us, all of us, whether we know we're lost or not, or even whether we think we are looking for God or not, God is seeking us. God seeks the lost, continually looking, searching, finding, and then ultimately and always inviting. Each of us has heard that call to follow Jesus. Maybe we haven't responded yet, and that may be the issue you deal with in that lostness in your life. But you see, Philip found his friend then after that. And even when he was skeptical about this guy from Nazareth, Philip didn't get mad at him. He said, come and see. You see, that's what we need to hear today. We need to hear someone say to us, come and see, and let's be about finding and following Jesus. They found Jesus. And they followed him. I hope you will make that decision if you have not today. That in the midst of all that's going on in your life, that lostness, that feeling of being overwhelmed, all the stuff of the world crashing in on you, it's not all yours. Give it away. It belongs to God, and you belong to God. The lostness is something we set aside as Jesus finds us and we make that decision to follow. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, thank you. It is a day today like no other day. Because you have created it for us, you have filled it with opportunities for us, and Lord, you brought us here today to be among your people, your church family, And we thank you, God, that you continually keep looking for us and you find us. In the midst of all the stuff that's going on in our lives, oh God, you find us and you call us. And you simply say, follow me. God, help us that we may be one of the partners in ministry that you need. Not just here on Sundays, but throughout the week and in our relationships with others. Forgive us when we mess that up and when we step away from what you want us to do. Oh God, help us to be the best that we can be for you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. A closing hymn today is, we are called to be God's people. It's a wonderful hymn. It's not one of those from 300 years ago. The words were written in 1973. Relatively new, but they mean a lot to me, and I hope they do to you as you sing and you share these together with this affirmation of we are called to be God's people. If you would like, and if you're able, if you'd want to stand with us as we sing. Thank you for singing joyously that prayer as we make that statement that we indeed are called to be God's people, servants, prophets, speaking for the truth and right. As you go from here today, think of those two words, finding and following. What is it that's lost? Who is it that's lost? How can you help them find? And how is it that you are helping to find Jesus? And how is it that in these days ahead, you are following him in all that you do? As you go from here, know that God walks with you every day because he's created you for this purpose. His son Jesus died to redeem you from your sins, and the Spirit of God dwells within you always to strengthen you and give you courage. Go from here in the peace of Christ and make a difference in God's world today. Amen.